I will try to stress the concept that it is not new, even if it's apparently new. The concept of the sick globe. But if you look at the anatomy, you can have a look in more than one century ago, of this paper. Dr. Lobner, carcinoma organization of human breast tissue is relevant in disease and the research objective vector mapping of parenchyma in complete breast. This is a project of Astrid Cooper of 1848. And also, breast carcinoma with multiple sites of origin described by Qualheim, several investigators, notably Chitter and Cutler, have demonstrated several instances of breast cancer with a multicentric character. Utilizing a large serial section and reconstructing the mammary duct system in graphic fashion, these authors showed that intraductal carcinoma often involved one or more entire ducts, including the final ramification. It's Gallagher is the author that described first the early carcinoma of the breast, and they made the reconstruction with the diagrammatic representation of the formation of an nabi carcinoma by coalescence of multiple contiguous arising carcinoma. And also representation of formation of stellate carcinoma. Well, this is the ductal tree, and inside the duct there is carcinoma. Human mammary carcinoma is not a focal process, but a disease which affects breast epithelia diffusely. The supportive connective tissue is also affected by carcinogenic agents. The earliest histological recognized change in the sequence which eventuates an invasive mammary carcinoma is epithelial hyperplasia. But epithelial hyperplasia of mammary ducts in the lobus is best regarded as a non-obligate perineoplastic lesion. If you have a typical hyperplasia, it's a perineoplastic lesion. The stage of intraepithelial non-invasive carcinoma precedes infiltrating mammary cancer. Concurrent invasion at multiple sites from pre-existing carcinoma in situ is a common phenomenon, and the mammary carcinoma might spread within the breast either by the formation of a new invasive nodules from intraductal carcinoma or by local lymphatic spread or both. The configuration of an invasive mammary carcinoma may be a reflection of its rate of growth. After the publication of this book, made by Towson, illustrated by Craig, I start to perform this principle and start with making section of the old specimen. It's a cancer disease, it's a very dense tissue, the cancer is here, having a big litigation with my pathologist because it was against the large section of the pathology. The breast system of branching ducts is arranged in a segmental, roughly radial pattern made by Page, one of the most important pathologists in breast. The breast has 15 to 20, some for some other there is more, some for some other there is less, but the lobes are ill-defined and not appreciated by on-cross inspection. Cavassoli is another important pathology for breast. McCarthy referred to 15-25 lobes and stated that each lobe is surrounded by connective tissue. Lobes in galactogram, here lobe, and also this graphic model of intraductal extension of breast carcinoma made by Otake in 1995. Intraductal invasive ductal carcinoma predominant with intraductal component, schematic diagram of the tumors together with the ductal lobular system made by Ohuche, who proposed the breast conserving surgery as segmental resection, like sector. The breast has many lobes, which are highly variable inside the shape, each with one central duct, its peripheral branch, and they are associated with glandular tissue. Better knowledge of human ductal lobar anatomy, ductal lobar unit, is essential for understanding the early origin of cancer and the rational design and the evolution of a large format section is the only way to make comparison with imaging and ultrasound and understand how we can better treat every patient. All drugs and their branch in an autopsy breast with a face, each Roman novel refers to a different independent taxon. Is a page, paper published by Going 2004. And more recently, a clear hypothesis of a cyclob has been made by Tibor Toth. He published a lot of paper after also a lot of book. And the normal representation, new normal representation of the breast anatomy is a lobe. It's a lobe. Each lobe has an independent duct and peripheral duct lobular unit is inside. A human breast is not one gland, but many, each with its own central milk collecting duct in the nipple and several orders of branching tributary ducts draining the secretory glandular tissue. It's a representation by Going and Moffat in 2004. Post one state the majority of studies of human mammary duct anatomy have demonstrated that each ductal system is comprised of ducts that open at the nipple through the one of five or nine orifices and branch into smaller and smaller. An investigation into the region of development of breast cancer in rodents have revealed that most breast cancer begin in the terminal ductal lobular units of an individual duct, which consists of a small segment of duct and a cluster of lobules. Non-invasive disease, such as duct carcinoma in situ, is usually localized by a single ductal system. Since the study of Wellings in 1980, we have known that breast carcinoma is primarily a disease of terminal ductal lobular units in the epithelial tissue of the duct. The carcinoma arises from the epithelial cells of the duct. Now, always more frequently, the breast is imaged in this way, like a lobus, even if some people doesn't recognize. Breast carcinoma is a lobar disease in the meaning that simultaneously or asynchronously appearing often multiple inside or invasive tumor foci originate in a single lobe of the one breast. It's the theory of the sick lobe made by Tibor Toth. The development of cancer in situ within the sick lobe may be unifocal, multifocal, or diffuse. Similarly, invasive growth may appear at a single locus, at a several distant loci, or over a large area within the breast tissue. The volume of breast tissue involved in this process is observed to be variable. It can be many cubic centimeters inside from the beginning of the process and can expand via invasion beyond the limits of the sick lobe at a more advanced stage. Most breast carcinoma exhibit complex subacral morphology. Approximately one third of invasive cases are unifocal with a single invasive focus and an inside component within and or in the vicinity of this focus. Another third of the cases are characterized by the presence of a single invasive focus but associated with a diffuse or multifocal inside component. The final third of the case exhibit a multifocal invasive component. The lobar nature of a breast carcinoma is easiest to observe at an in situ or millimetric invasive phases. You can see unifocal, multifocal, and diffuse. Morphologic evidence. The sick lobe theory connects breast carcinogenesis to an anatomically well-defined structure. This is the lobe. The lobes are individual units, and the spread of cancer cells from the one lobe to another is extremely rare, but it can occur. Simultaneous involvement of several lobes in the same breast is possible in a multicenter cancer. It is important to delineate such rare multicenter cases from the much more common multifocal cancer, in which the multiple tumor foci are localized within the same lobe. I have never found more than one ductal system involved in spite of multiple lesions scattered by mammography. They always seem to connect to a single ductal tree, as William Dolly, pathologist of University of Oklahoma. Also, Dolly said, as in the classic Tibor Toth description, the entire lobe is occasionally involved because of the initiation events occurred in some of the first stem cells of the lobe early in its development. Here, either complete lobe excision or whole breast treatment might be required. The pattern of spread of intraductal carcinoma has a pyramid-like shape with a summit toward and occasionally extended to the nipple. And in 27 of 30 mastectomy, specimen contains DCIS, invasive carcinoma, adibial ductal hyperplasia, cell ductal hyperplasia, were confirmed to the area of the single active duct. The pattern of cancer development seems to be the most typical of the early stage. The peripheral pattern involving the terminal ductal lobular units, the segmental pattern involving a segmental duct together with its branch and terminal units, the lobar pattern involving the entire cyst lobe or larger parts of it. When describing malignant lesion at the breast, the following morphological parameters should be listed, independent of the use of imaging technique: the size of the tumor corresponds to the largest diameter, the distribution of the lesion as a unifocal multifocal diffuse separately for invasive and incisor lesion, the extent of disease representing the whole area including all the invasive and incisor malignant structure, position of the tumor within the breast, evidence of intratumoral or intertumoral heterogeneity, more evident today with the new research in biology. We consider well-defined invasive foci to be individual foci when they were delineated from each other by tissue that did not contain invasive structure, irrespective of the distance between the foci or the quadrant localization of the foci. It has unifocal localized in one lobe or in neighboring lobes, multifocal localized in lobes distant to each other, diffuse involving larger ducts. The theory of the sick lobe and the theory of biological timing connected the process of a carcinogenesis to an existing and well-defined anatomic structure. Breast lobe and provide the possible explanation for the progressive character and morphological heterogeneity of breast carcinoma. What is the approach? Tailored and systematic radiology pathologic correlation, routine use of a large format histologic section studying 3D images, and systematic follow up. The traditional method of ultrasound imaging produces orthogonal slices of the breast and is not appropriate for visualization of the lobes. Only the ductal radial echography approach is able to visualize the lobe and their contents. Using this technique, we often find the early stage cancer located at the meeting point between the ductal axis and the axis of the Cooper ligament. The imaging approach has to be multimodal, meaning that a synthesis of information gathered by different modern breast imaging modality, mammography, ultrasound, magnetic resonance imaging, should be used to compensate the limitation of each of the individual methods and to provide the best possible basis for therapeutic decision making. Scanning ductal system by the ductal echography, we systematically follow the paths of the ducts in the best way to find diagnosing stage and guide surgery. Here's the duct along the major axis. Ultrasound heterogeneity and appearance depends on the local shell of the tumor. If you have a peripheral or more central, you have a different morphology of the cancer. The problem of the sick lobe comes how we can recognize the lobe and how we can apply this theory to the operative surgeon in order to perform the best work in conserving surgery. It has been previously reported that intratumoral proliferative growths in 42% that extended beyond the imaging and the planned excision margin. The use of a new high-frequency, high-resolution ultrasound transducer and duct endoscopy may give more detailed information on the change of ducts within the ductal lobular tree. The model proposed by Edgerton, 2011, assumes a resection volume of an ellipsoid concordant with a sick lobe that is antithetical to surgical approach which prescribe circular or spherical resection around the tumor that fails to conform to the patterns of tumor progression and dissemination which has been independently validated by work in different studies, in this lumpectomy. An elliptical resection not only optimizes the resection of the ciclo, but leaves a resection defect that can be closed by a simple mobilization of full thickness of both parenchymal flaps and direct closure with a reasserable suture. Sorry, this is a sector or segment, elliptical form is lumpectomy. In the revised literature, we paid a great tribute to the volume of excited tissue, to the weight of excited tissue. Are we sure that in order to guarantee a good cosmetic result, we have to take in consideration only these factors and nothing to the biology and anatomy of breast cancer? If cyclobe concept is correct, why many surgeons still perform mini lumpectomy without an anatomic concept? This lumpectomy of central lumpectomy, this peripheral lumpectomy. The typical more frequent lumpectomy here is a lobar section with double lung curve, lung line incision for cancer near to the superficial layer. How to overcome failure? In a recent paper published in June 2017 of the Journal of Nuclear Medicine, Ernie Purushottam, right, currently approximately in 1 in 5, 20% women who undergo breast conserving surgery, known as lumpectomy, require repeated surgery due to inadequate excision of the tumor during the initial surgical procedure. May we consider that this type of surgery is not adequate taking account of the anatomy? Mikhail, reoperation potentially have several negative consequences, including the late onset of adjuvant therapy, worse cosmetic result, increased patient distress, increased the recurrence rate, decreased the survival, overall management more expensive. Because of the morphological variability of proper intraorbital mapping of the lobes and the identification border of the cyclobe, it's very difficult. Removing a lobe like oval or triangular piece of tissue depending from the site of the tumor, more central or more peripheral. Segmental resection seems to be a more appropriate approach in context of the cyclobe concept. It's a lobar resection and lumpectomy. It's a totally different approach. From oncological point of view, the excision of breast cancer through the lobar resection along removal of the entire disease lobe is not a more aggressive surgery. It is an anatomic resection. If we perform this type of surgery, maybe we can image a trial without subsequent aggressive therapies that have important distant and side effects now clearly evident in the literature. It's a shaving cavity, it's the segmentectomy sector. Plan for lobar resection for a T1B cancer with the skin incision called the Langer's line. It's a more aesthetic. Image-guided surgery allows to enhance the surgeon's capability to utilize medical imaging to decrease the invasiveness of surgical procedure and increase their accuracy and safety. This concept can be categorized into perform one or more of the following functions: staging, surgical planning, localization, surgical guidance with intraoperative updates. The need for better image quality arises because some anatomical structures are difficult to distinguish. It's a smooth cancer inside the very dense tissue. The cyclope concept and our guidelines for application to conserve surgery is that the lobar resection represent a great deviation from recent traditional lumpectomy. We stress other surgeons to consider this proposal and to realize the lobar and ductal anatomy in order to motivate surgical innovation following anatomical and imaging guidelines and realize a multicenter prospective randomized trial to test the validity of this concept and the surgical approach that would fundamentally change local therapy. The current trend towards more and more reduced surgery is based on previous studies demonstrating a decline in the frequency of local recurrence after breast conserving surgery. In contrast, several studies have indicated that there is a high risk of local recurrence in multifocal invasive cancer, extensive tumors which are associated with an extensive high-grade in-situ component. Online 90 reported that 71% of extensive ductal component in a positive patient had residual DCIS compared with 28% of extensive intraductal cancer negative patient. In particular, 44% of extended positive had prominent residual CIS compared with 3% of extensive intact component negative patient. This may explain the association between extensive intact cancer and subsequent recurrence in patients treated with a limited excision before radiotherapy. Tot and Gir in 2016 reported that 44.5% of the tumors judged as unifocal based on the preoperative multimodal radiology workup had separate invasive and or in situ foci on large format histopathology slides. This foci occupied an area of about 40 millimeters in 29% of cases, indicating extensive diseases. Close or dirty matches, upon histological examination was associated with extensive disease, multifocality, and breast conservation. Thus, removing the radiologic detected tumor foci focus with no ink on the tumor may not be sufficient in such cases. It is essential for surgeons and the radiologist to understand the origin of the and extending pattern of cancer and make the surgical margins negative in breast conservation surgery. The lower distribution of cancer influences the extent of excision, and to reach this goal, it is fundamental for surgeons to master intraoperative ultrasound. Segmentectomy, ductal lobular segmentectomy proposed by Uchi, sectariectomy should become accepted as a more adequate approach to or the method of choice in this surgery, provided that the theory of the sacrum is correct. Using adequate imaging in pathological workup of specimen has to influence pathologists and other best team members to change the standard widely accepted either image of breast cancer as a lump into understanding breast cancer as a lifelong, progressive, often multifocal, heterogeneous, and extensive disease involving a whole breast lobe. We must tend towards a new era of a multimodal approach, an era in which clinicians must be more and more open to modifying therapeutic decisions for multifocal lesions guided by imaging, an era in which the concept of multifocality within the same lobe is recognized in TNM, an era in which the follow-up for multifocal becomes sufficiently long to provide important information, an area in which the lesion distribution and disease extent will become accepted prognostic parameters with the clinical importance equal to dominant tumor sites. The use of ultrasound is continuously evolving as occurs for every equipment due to technological improvement. In the same way, physicians should be able to improve their capacities in their utilization of the new equipments with enlarged indication and outstanding principle. Ultrasound is the first line and the most cost-effective methods to stage the breast become increasingly important for guiding adequate surgical treatment. The role of surgery in the management of breast cancer has changed markedly, reflecting the innovation in breast imaging. Why not combine the concept of the sacral lobe with the use of ultrasound guiding the surgeon according to the anatomy of the lobe? We dedicate this book, the editor is Dominique Amé, to the lobe approach on breast ultrasound, not only for diagnosis, but also for therapy. If you are interested, it's of Springer. You can have a look of the reference on the stick. Thank you for your attention. If you have a question, I know that there is a difficult topic, but the anatomy is important. Pathology is important when we use imaging and knife. But if it's fundamental, the women doesn't come back for a new operation. It's fundamental.